starting with the nerve supply of the upper limb, let us first discuss about the brachial plexus. So the objectives of today's lecture, we are going to study the formation of brachial plexus and their branches, and at last we will discuss the clinical anatomy associated with it. So first let us see what is the meaning of brachial plexus. So continuing with the brachial plexus, let us see what is the meaning of brachial plexus. Brachium refers to the arm, and the plexus means there are the group of axons lying outside the central nervous system. Plexus is nothing but the group of axons lying outside the central nervous system is known as plexus. So group of axons outside CNS. Group of axons outside the CNS is called as the plexus. So these brachial plexus are the chief nerve supply of the entire upper limb. Mainly the branches which are arising from the brachial plexus gives innervation to the anterior and posterior compartments of the entire upper limb. So these brachial plexus, after they form, they pass laterally from the neck and through the axilla they enter into the arm. So first let us study about the formation of brachial plexus. So we have to study about the formation of brachial plexus. So if you see here, the brachial plexus are formed by the ventral ramae of C5, C6, C7, C8 and the most of the T1. So I can say the anterior primary ramae or the ventral ramae, because each spinal segment has a ventral ramae and a dorsal ramae or posterior ramae. The ventral ramae of C5, C6, C7, C8 and T1 forms the brachial plexus, and the same segments from the posterior ramae gives innervation to the muscles of the back, or I can say the muscles of the upper back. So that's why you should say that the brachial plexus are formed by the ventral ramae of the nerve roots C5, C6, C7, C8 and T1. So here, from medial to lateral, the parts of the brachial plexus, or we can say how the brachial plexus we are going to study, or first we will study the roots of the brachial plexus, means from where they originate. After the roots, we are going to discuss about the trunks, and the trunks forms divisions. After the divisions, we are going to discuss about the cords and finally branches. So from medial to lateral are, so from medial to lateral, we are going to study the brachial plexus. First we are going to study about the roots of the brachial plexus. And after the roots, we are going to discuss about the trunks. And after the trunks, divisions. Divisions. Next is cords, and finally its branches. Okay, So like this, first let us study about the roots of the brachial plexus. As I already mentioned you that the roots of the brachial plexus are formed by the anterior primary rami of the spinal segments C5 to T1. So here, one important point you should know. So immediately after the roots are formed, or I can say close to the origin of the roots, mainly it receives gray rami communicants from sympathetic trunk. What it is, I will explain you. This is the origin. So immediately close to the origin, this is close to the origin, it receives gray rami communicants from the sympathetic trunk. Let us think that this is the sympathetic trunk. In the sympathetic trunk, this is called as the superior cervical ganglia, and this is called as the inferior cervical ganglia, superior as well as inferior cervical ganglia. So from these cervical ganglia, the roots receives the postganglionic fibers. So here you can see the roots receives postganglionic sympathetic fibers to supply to the periphery. So immediately after the roots are formed, that is close to the origin of the roots receive gray rami communicants from the sympathetic trunk. That is, their postganglionic fibers enters into the roots to supply to the periphery. Okay? And these roots, after they form, they pass laterally and they unite to form trunks. So after this is what is called as the roots. After roots, we are going to discuss about the trunks of the brachial plexus. After the roots, we are discussing about the trunks of the brachial plexus. So you should say here that the roots unite to form trunks. So like it, if you see C5 and C6 combine to form upper trunk, and C7 continues as a middle trunk, and here C8 and T1 unite to form lower trunk. So what it is? This is upper trunk. C5 and C6 unite to form upper trunk. C7 continues as middle trunk, and C8 and T1 continues to form lower trunk. So like this, we have totally three trunks of the brachial plexus: upper trunk, middle trunk, as well as lower trunk. If you see the relation of these trunks in the neck with respect to the subclavian artery, mainly the trunks are posterior to the subclavian artery in the neck. And if you speak more specifically, the lower trunk is over the first rib, that is exactly posterior to the subclavian artery. But the middle as well as upper trunk are more superior towards the subclavian artery. So here I am explaining you the relations of the trunks with respect to the top subclavian artery in the neck. As I mentioned you that these trunks in the neck are posterior to the subclavian artery, but specifically the lower trunk, which lies on the first ray, that is posterior to the subclavian artery, exactly posterior to the subclavian artery, the lower trunk, but the middle trunk and upper trunk are more superior when compared to that of the lower trunk, or you can say more superior and towards posterior aspect of the subclavian artery. So here, as I mentioned you that after the origin from the roots, that is C5 to T1, the brachial plexus pass laterally to reach the posterior triangle of the neck. They pass laterally to reach posterior triangle of the neck. So while the roots as well as trunks passing towards the posterior triangle of the neck, they pass between the anterior and middle scalene muscles. So here I will show you. For example, this is the anterior and middle scalene muscles, anterior as well as middle. After the origin, C5, C6, C7, C8 and T1, the roots unite to form trunks. These trunks enter the posterior triangle of the neck. These trunks enter posterior triangle of the neck by passing between anterior and middle scalene muscles. Okay? So if you see the relations of these brachial plexus, you can say that anteriorly it is related to the anterior scalene muscles, which means it mainly passes between the anterior as well as middle scalene muscles, and posteriorly it is related to the middle scalene muscles, like that it is. Okay? So like that they pass laterally to the posterior triangle by passing between these anterior and middle scalene muscles. So these are called as the trunks of the brachial plexus. Roots unite to form trunks. So after the trunks, we have to discuss about the divisions of brachial plexus. We have to discuss about the divisions of brachial plexus. Okay? So each trunk gives two divisions, that is anterior division and posterior division. Each trunk gives two divisions, one is anterior division and another one is posterior division. Okay, so like that, upper trunks gives two divisions, anterior and posterior. Middle trunk gives two divisions, anterior and posterior. Afterwards, the lower trunk also gives two divisions, that is anterior as well as posterior. Anterior as well as posterior. So, these are the divisions of the brachial plexus. What it is? The anterior division, and there are three posterior divisions. So this is also anterior division, posterior division. So remember that posterior division is a dotted line. So this is the posterior division and this is the anterior division. So each trunk divides into two divisions, that is anterior as well as posterior divisions. Here, all the anterior divisions of the brachial plexus, which forms the part of brachial plexus which gives innervation to the muscles of anterior compartment of arm and forearm. So what is the anterior compartment of the upper limb? The anterior compartment of the upper limb is known as the flexor compartment. So by this we can say that the entire flexor compartment of the arm and forearm is innervated by the anterior divisions of the brachial plexus, or we can say the parts of the brachial plexus which forms the anterior divisions gives innervation to the anterior compartment of the upper limb, or we can say the flexor compartment of the upper limb. So from here you should remember that the entire flexor muscles, the flexor compartment of the upper limb, is innervated by the nerves which are originated, the nerves which are originated after the contributions of anterior divisions of brachial plexus, right? So here these are the anterior divisions. In the same way, the posterior divisions of the brachial plexus forms the part of the brachial plexus which gives innervation to the posterior compartment of the arm and forearm. So like that, all the anterior divisions contribute to the nerve supply to the anterior compartment of the upper limb. And in the same way, all the three posterior divisions from superior, middle as well as inferior trunk gives contribution to the posterior compartment of the upper limb. So one is the anterior compartment and other one is posterior compartment. So now it will be very easy for you to remember which branch of the brachial plexus gives nerve supply to the which compartment. Okay, so these are the divisions. Now these divisions again unite to form cords. So here I will show you how they unite to form cords. So the anterior division of upper trunk and the anterior division of middle trunk unite to form lateral cord. So here I will show you the anterior division of upper trunk and the anterior division of middle trunk unite to form the lateral cord. Got it? And here the anterior division of the lower trunk continues itself to form medial cord. So this is called as the medial cord. Okay, and next you can see the three dotted lines here. So let us continue with the dotted lines only. So the three posterior divisions of upper trunk and the posterior division of the middle trunk and the posterior division of the lower trunk unite to form the posterior cord of the brachial plexus. So I'll repeat once again. The brachial plexus are formed by the anterior primary ramen, that is the ventral ramen of C5, C6, C7, C8 and T1. And the roots unite to form trunks, like that C5, C6 unite to form upper trunk. C7 continues itself to form middle trunk. And C8 and T1 continues, or C8 and T1 unites to form the lower trunk of the brachial plexus. These trunks are giving off divisions. So each trunk gives two divisions. One is the anterior division and other one is the posterior division. So like that, the anterior divisions of the upper as well as the middle trunk unites to form the lateral cord of the brachial plexus. So you can see here. And the anterior division of the lower trunk continues itself to form the medial cord of the brachial plexus. So by this you can say that the lateral cord as well as the medial cord gives innervation to the anterior compartment of the upper limb, because we already studied that The parts of the brachial plexus from the anterior divisions gives nerve supply to the flexor compartment, that is the anterior compartment of the arm as well as forearm. So like that, the lateral cord as well as medial cord. So whatever may be the branches arising from the lateral cord as well as the medial cord, remember that they are giving nerve supply to the flexor muscles. And all the branches which are arising from the posterior cord of the brachial plexus gives innervation to the posterior compartment, that is called as the extensor muscles of the arm as well as forearm. So like this, this is the formation of the brachial plexus, that is roots, trunks, divisions, cords.